welcome, be invited as you, to your friends, relatives, and loved ones. It's good to see each and every one of you here. And I hope and I believe the Lord will bless each and every one by the music and also the message. So with that, as soon as I get a thumbs
it's on.
Up on the...
It's on.
What's that?
It's on.
Oh, it is on?
Yeah.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
I guess we're going to go live here now.
Mm-hmm.
So the individuals who are joining us via the media system, we welcome you here this evening to this third session here of revival, a much needed issue in the church. As I spoke of last night and Sunday morning, revival is for the believers. It is for the church where we get fired up enough to know that we can go out into the world and offer the much needed help given by Christ Jesus. And if you're fearful of not being able to share, I invite you to take a look at our track table here and on the back two windowsills. There's some information there that will help you, even if it's giving a track to someone that you know or asking them, would you like a track? They're very helpful. It's one of those things that just they'll stick in their coat pocket. You can stick them in your coat pocket. I occasionally, when I go to a restaurant, when I'm leaving a tip, the tip goes in the tract, and then I leave it there. So it's just a way of reaching out to someone who may not know Jesus Christ or someone who is struggling with a lot of things that are in their life. And they can be assisted and taken care of through the Lord Jesus and the sacrificials that he did on Calvary's cross for the sins of this world. And there's a lot of them out there. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather again here this evening in your house with your people. Lord, we've been praying for revival, and the messages and the music have been reflective of that. Still within our hearts, stoke that fire that's in our being, that we can be like, feels like fire in my bones. You can't keep it quiet when we share the Holy Ghost with someone and also with those that we know and we love. We would ask that you would be with the singers this evening and also be with the messenger. Lord, we look forward to seeing how you're going to bring forth this service. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen. At this time, I'll have our music ministry come.
We want to introduce. Are we going to do the theme song?
Whenever she walked in the... Oh, yeah.
The theme song.
Excuse me, I keep forgetting. We've got to do our theme song.
He's the one that chose it.
Over the last couple of years, we've had... he's made a change. This year, it's a shout in time in heaven. So... let's sing our theme song.
He just gets so excited.
Yeah.
I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms. In the arms of Christ my Savior. Oh, it's shouting time in heaven, a sinner once lost is found. It's shouting time in heaven, salvation has been brought down. No wonder the angels rejoice to know my sins have been covered by the crimson flow. Now I'm feeling fine. I'm walking on the highway with my Lord, my name's written down in courts above. It's shouting time in heaven. Oh yes, it's shouting time. Come ye weary, heavy laden, lost and ruined by the fall. If you tarry till you're better, you will never come back. It's shouting time in heaven, a sinner once lost is found. It's shouting time in heaven, salvation's been brought down. No wonder the angels just to know my sins have been covered by the crimson flow. Now I'm feeling fine. I'm walking in the highway with my Lord. My name's written down in the courts above. It's shouting time in heaven. Oh yes, it's shouting time. It's shouting time in heaven. A sinner once lost is found. It's shouting time in heaven. Salvation's been brought down. No wonder the angels rejoice to know my sins have been covered by the crimson flow. Now I'm feeling fine. I'm walking on the highway with my Lord. My name's written down in the courts above. It's shouting time in heaven. Oh yes, it's shouting time.
Pause with music.
Pause with the music.
It's shouting time in heaven. Oh yes, it's shouting time.
Woo!
Okay, Scott, I got it warmed up.
You did a good job. It's shouting time in heaven. How about a little shouting time here in church?
How about it?
I get to come right down here and sing right amongst you all tonight because I brought a microphone and it doesn't work. So I'm going to come right down here and sing to you. sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. The only Bible that my daddy laid beside his bed, an heirloom handed down across 100 yesterdays. I never heard him read it much, but I knew it had been read. For the pages of the life he lived said more than words say. They say, son, gone, he still lives on when his memory talks to me. Saying, son, love your brother more than you love yourself. Forgive as you would like to be forgiven. And make your life an example for everyone to see. You might be Bible another man ever reads. And when my boy becomes a man, I hope that he will see the kind of life my father lived, speaking truth through me. Saying, son, love your brother more than you love yourself. Forgive as you would like. And make your life an example for everyone to see. You might be the only Bible another man ever reads. You might be the only Bible. Sing a song that really means a lot to me. My wife is one of her favorite songs as well. You know, today in this world that we're living in, it's so easy to be distracted with everything that's going on around us and turn our eyes to everything, especially the phones today. The phones can instantly take your mind from something positive to something negative in a split second. And this song, I think, will touch a lot of you and speak to you and maybe make you think a little bit about, number one, how we spend our time every day, and number two, of how we need to stay rooted in God's Word, because we are being challenged at an all-time high right now. A song called Only You. Lord, I want to be ready. Always willing to follow you, able to make any sacrifice you want me to. I'm not things get the best of me. So remove every idol until you're all I want and need. Just the basics for survival. Take it all until I see only you. Only you. I keep my life so busy. Always have some place to be. All along, you simply want to speak to me. I've got every convenience to save me time and energy. But at the end of the day, what does that all mean? So remove every item till you're all I want and need. Just the basics for survival. Take it all until I see only you. Only till you're all I want and need. Just the basics for survival. Take it all until I see only you. Only
love, Lord.
Josh, I'm looking forward to hearing you speak tonight, brother. So how many people have decided to follow Jesus?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's sing this one out, okay? You all know this one. Well, I have decided to follow Jesus, and I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided.
Thank you.
Long way around. Good evening.
Good evening.
Long before I was a pastor, I would get up in front of churches to speak, and that's my absolute favorite part, is the call and response when I say good morning or good evening, and you all say it back. So thank you. You didn't know that, but thanks for indulging me. My name is Josh Wallace. I pastor at Watson Town, so just a little jump down the river. And in addition to pastoring at Watson Town, I am a chaplain at the Lewisburg Penitentiary. So one of my congregations you can come to anytime you want to. The other congregation, you must be indicted to be invited. So I don't care if you have a good lawyer, I'd rather see you here than there. But funny story, it's Rob, right?
Scott,
I'm sorry, I don't know why Rob's stuck in my head.
Rob's my brother-in-law, that works just fine.
Okay, we're going to go with Scott. Funny story about I've decided to follow Jesus. At the congregation inside the penitentiary, one evening I was preaching, and that song went perfect with the message that I was going to deliver. So we have a guy who belongs on American Idol or America's Got Talent. This guy has a gospel voice like you have never heard. It's incredible. And his name is Dupree. So I'm going down the hallway to where Dupree is sitting, and I go, Dupree, do you know I have decided to follow Jesus? And a Spanish inmate turns around and goes, that's what I'm talking about, chap! Yeah! He goes, like, no, I made that decision long ago. We just want to sing the hymn. But every time now I sing that hymn, I think of an inmate named, his nickname's Trouble. Go figure, right? So I'm going to open the Lord, open in prayer, ask the Lord's Lord to help me out, and we're going to get into the text, so pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to be here, and thank you for each heart that you brought out here tonight. God, we are here for you to ignite our hearts, maybe reignite our hearts, God, but to set us on fire that we would blaze for you, that everywhere we go, God, that our torch would be passed on to someone else. Be it through a tract, or be it through our lifestyle, like Scott sang about, God, or be it through the words of life that you have put in our mouth. God, I pray tonight as I proclaim those same words that you would that I would empty out and you would fill me up to overflow, and that you would do in the hearts of the men what I am incapable of doing as a mere man. God, do something supernatural here this evening. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so open your Bibles to the book of Acts. And as you're opening to Acts, go to chapter 20. And before I get started in the text, I'll make my first point. If you don't have a Bible, grab one out of the pew.
Yeah.
And if you don't come to church with the Bible, next time, do. Revival is going to start when the Word of God penetrates our hearts. And faith comes through hearing, but boy, when you're interacting with the text as I'm delivering it to you, it's something special what God is able to do. This is also the only time it's acceptable to have your phones out in church, because I know you have a Bible app. I'm a preacher. I have four. So it's, you know, but open it up to the God, or the book of Acts, 2 Luke, I call it, chapter 20. And we're going to begin the reading in verse 17 down through probably close to the end of the chapter. Paul records for us in Acts. From Miletus, Paul sent to Ephesus for the elders of the church. When they arrived, he said to them, "You know how I lived the whole time I was with you. From the first day I came into the province of Asia, I served the Lord with great humility and with tears, although I was severely tested by the plots of the Jews. You know that I have not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you, but have taught you publicly and from house to house. I've declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. And now, compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace. Now I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will I ever see again. Therefore, I declare to you today that I am innocent of the blood of all men, for I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God." Some Bibles say the whole counsel of God. "Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw disciples after them. Mm-hmm. So be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years I never stopped warning each of you day and night with tears. Now I commit you to God and the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I've not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. You yourselves know that these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companions. In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work we must help the weak, remembering the words the Lord Jesus himself said, 'It is more blessed to give than to receive.' When he had said this, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. What grieved them most was his statement that they would never see his face again. Then they accompanied him to the ship." This may seem like an odd text for revival, but the Lord laid it on my heart almost after I was asked to come back that this would be the text to preach. In all of Paul's addresses, this is the only one that he gives specifically to a Christian audience. Ronnie pointed out the revival is for the church. Revival is for the Christian. What happens out there is evangelism. Mm-hmm. What happens in here is revival. That's why I pray that God would ignite or reignite a passion in our hearts. Later on, as Paul's John is writing to the church in Ephesus, he commends them for so many things. But one thing he says, "I have this thing against you. You've forsaken your first love." This is the same church that Paul, that is the same church that Paul is writing to here. So I tend to go down verse by verse. So if you have your Bibles, it'll be really easy to follow along. In verse 17, Paul is traveling back towards Jerusalem, but he makes a stop. He makes port in Miletus, and he sends to Ephesus to get the elders there. It's about a 30-mile trip inland, and he has the elders come out to where he is. And when he comes to them, he reminds them, "You yourselves know how I lived among you. the whole time. Paul was in Ephesus ministering for 3 years. Some of the things that he encountered while he was there. He taught them, he encouraged them, and he discipled them. A miniature Pentecost broke out with a man named Apollos who had received the gospel or the baptism of John, which is a baptism of repentance, but he had never heard of the Holy Spirit. He didn't know. He wanted to change his behavior. Repent, right, means to turn around, but he didn't have the help of the Holy Spirit to do that. That's the promise of every believer. The things that God calls us to do, we are weak, but he is strong, right? That's what the old children's song says. Mm-hmm. So he sees a little Pentecost break out in Acts 19. At one point, a riot breaks out in the city of Ephesus because there's a temple there to a goddess named Artemis. The Latin, her name is Diana. And there's a thriving business around the crafting of idols of Artemis. And there's a silversmith, Demetrius. And Paul is so successful in preaching Christ inside the city that the people, the pagans who practiced idolatry and sorcery and witchcraft, brought all of their spell books and Harry Potter books and magic wands, and they put them all in the middle of the city, and they lit them on fire. And it was such an expensive cost to themselves. And then the silversmiths are like, he's cutting into our business. This guy's got to go. So they whip up a mob into a frenzy, and they try to run him out of town. And you know what Paul does? That's what I love about Paul. Paul goes, look, there's a crowd of people outside. I want to go preach to them. We look at our lives and we go, safety first. Paul goes, safety last. These folks need the gospel. And he wanted to go out there, but the disciples were holding him back. And I can just see Paul like, let me at him. Let me at him. Like the old Scrappy Doo cartoon, right? I can take him. I got the Holy Spirit. But this is one of the things that happened while he was there. People were healed. So Ephesus is a really, it's a hot and arid climate. There's a story about it that people would work through the morning up to about 11 a.m. Then they would take a siesta from 11 to 4 p.m. because it was just too hot. And then from 4 p.m. into the evening, they would go back to work. It's been said of Ephesus that there were more people asleep at 1 p.m. than 1 a.m. Okay? So Paul, working, and he says, I supplied my own needs. I didn't covet anyone else's silver or gold. As he worked with his hands, his sweat rags, his handkerchiefs, people considered them so blessed and considered Paul so powerful that handkerchiefs were brought to people and they were healed. God healed them through the sweat rags of a great evangelist. Not only were people healed by sweat rags, but one night when Paul was preaching, it says he was rambling on, and I won't do that tonight. It says Paul was preaching well into midnight, and there was a young man standing on the third floor in the window to listen to Paul, and he got a little drowsy and fell asleep. Now, I've had people fall asleep in my sermons. When I read about this kid named Eutychus, I take great comfort. They fell asleep on Paul, too. So, Ron, if it ever happens, just know we're in good company.
Yeah.
Okay? Eutychus fell out of the third-story window, and we know that Luke, the doctor, wrote the book of Acts. He records Eutychus was dead. Yes. Paul's like, this is looking... I've been interrupted in a lot of things by a sermon. Never someone died. And Paul was undaunted. He goes up. He goes, that's no trouble for me. Get up. And he picked him up. He rose him up, sent him back up to the third floor. And Paul went back to preaching.
Yep.
Right? These are the things that they saw, that the Ephesian church saw while Paul was at work. He says, you know how I lived amongst you the whole time from the first day I got there. And the reason I point out that this address is for Christians because I want to draw examples from the text about what it's like for us to live our lives in front of people, because that is Paul's ministry. It's preaching, but it's setting an example for the churches that he lived. He would go on to say, imitate me only as I imitate Christ. Do what I do. Our Lord Jesus gave us and he lived his life as an example. So our Christian faith is a doing faith. We look to people whom we admire. We look to strong examples in the faith to know how we ought to live our lives and how we ought to love our Lord. Paul says, while I was with you, I served the Lord with humility. That's the number one thing that we need as Christians, because people don't want to look at a bunch of know-it-all. And look, this book, I'm going to manipulate it around the pulpit light there. This book does have all the answers to every question the world is asking. But if we go to them arrogantly, as if we have all the answers, we lose our humility. We need to go with them in our love. We want to level with people. We want to listen to them. We want to understand their need. And then we want to direct them to the answers. Now, people will go, well, that book's not going to tell me who to marry. It's not going to tell me where to go to college. I said, it's not going to tell you who to marry, but if you're a man, it's going to tell you to marry a woman.
Amen.
Right? The world is upside down. The things that the world teaches, dare I say, preaches, we're supposed to accept blindly. No, no. The Word of God, I contend to you that if me or Ron or any preacher says from behind a pulpit, because there are a lot of people that will stand behind podiums, open the Word of God, and never once look at it.
Mm-hmm.
But if a preacher stands behind a podium and says something from the Word of God that you don't like, your problem isn't with the preacher, it's with the author. You got to take it up with him, because everything that we say, if we're standing on the foundation of the Word of God, it's as true as the fact that the sky is blue and the sun's going to come up in the east.
Mm-hmm.
All day long. And Paul says, I served alongside you in humility. If anyone had bragging rights, you think the guy that raised up a kid who fell asleep during a sermon and was stealing people to sweat rags, if anyone had bragging rights, it was Paul. Because I, like it was in Corinth, when I was with him, I desired to know nothing but Christ and him crucified. It was the crux and the epitome of his message. He served with humility and with tears and with trials. Here's something that as we live out our Christian life, we're going to have struggles. Paul struggled internally. He was so burdened for the church. In 2 Corinthians, when he talks about, I've been in prison more than everybody else, I've been beaten more than everybody else, I've been shipwrecked, spent days at sea, I've been in danger in the country, danger in the city, danger in the valley, danger on the mountain, and he goes on and lists this laundry list of sufferings. At the bottom of it, he goes on top of all that, it's the burden I carry for all you in my churches that I have started. He is struggling internally because he loves so hard and so much, but he also has external struggles. All of those, for him, it comes from the plotting of the Jews, his own countrymen, the people who he would go on to say, my life would be accursed, I would be stricken from the Lamb's Book of Life if it just meant my countrymen would be saved. If we're going to live this life, we're going to have struggles. Jesus promised it, Paul acknowledges it, and we need to know that in this world, comfort and the easy streets, sunshine and rainbows, that is not our lot. It's just not. Not a very encouraging message for revival, but I want us to be, when it happens, I want us to be encouraged. James says, consider it pure joy. I think James must have had a screw loose. Consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds? I don't consider it joy. I get in my flesh right away. I get irritated. It bothers me. But then the Spirit that lives in me will convict me and say, no, there's an opportunity here. This is an opportunity for you, with all humility and love, to live out your faith in a difficult situation. You don't fly off the handle like the world does. You don't want to raise up. Like, I work inside a prison. I have a very predictable way of handling situations. And usually it's force with force. Only enough force to contain the situation, though. That's what the policy statement says. In the world, it doesn't work like that. My wife, I have two children. They're 6 and 8. My wife will tell me, do I keep walking out of frame? Is that
no? Me? You're
okay.
Good.
I don't want to.
Nope, you're good.
All right, I don't want to lose the feed in the live stream. But I have two daughters. They're 6 and 8, and my wife will accuse me. And sometimes she goes, "You have to stop talking to the girls like they're inmates." I said, "It's a default response. It happens, but they're not inmates. Right? I love them dearly." Anyway, we're going to have struggles. That's the point I want to get. We're going to have internal struggles. We're going to have external struggles. And it's just, it's going to happen as we live our life. Paul says that I didn't shrink from declaring to you that anything that was profitable. I love this. Preachers have soapboxes. We have our things that we just like to camp out on. If we don't know what to preach, we can go back to a topic and we can do this. But the best preaching, I guarantee you, is when you start a book and finish a book. And you deal with the whole counsel of God. Because when you preach, let's say you preach the Gospel of Matthew, and you get to the Sermon on the Mount. A, as a preacher, you feel pretty inadequate preaching the sermon that Jesus preached, don't you? But you're going to deal with topics inside the Sermon on the Mount that are really hard to talk about. Matthew 7, right? Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, And he'll say, depart from me, I never knew you. And then you've got to look at a congregation full of people, and you're going to listen to Jesus say that the broad and wide is the road that leads to destruction, and many find it, but narrow is the path that leads to life, and few will find it. And you've got to assume that there's a traffic flow issue here. The world confirms it. Is it AC/DC sings Highway to Hell? Zeppelin sings Stairway to Heaven. Zeppelin, right? I got to look at the musician on that one. Highway, stairway. The world confirms the truths of the Bible. But you won't preach those hard topics unless you're working through them. Because you don't just step up and say, today we're going to preach on, let's go, homosexuality and transgenderism inside the world. But when you are forced to encounter it through going through the text, you have to deal with these. And you can't pass over it. You can't end around it. And God forbid we soften what the Bible teaches about hard subjects. And Paul says, I did that when I was with you. I didn't cower back. I didn't hide. I didn't soften anything. And I taught you everything that was profitable. What that tells me is he taught them Scripture. Because all Scripture is God-breathed and profitable, useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness. Sometimes we need to be corrected. Sometimes we need to be rebuked. The Word of God is good for that. Because it's the Spirit of God convicting the Spirit in you to say, you're a little off course. Let's adjust. Let's correct here. Let's get you back on track. He says, I didn't shrink back from declaring to you and teaching you. So the word there, declaring, some Bibles it says preaching. There's a distinction in preaching and teaching. If you come to church and all you get is preached at, do this, don't do that, can't you read the sign? Thank you.
You're welcome.
Right? Do this, don't do that. If all you are is preached at and you're never taught that, never taught how to do the thing you're preaching about, you're only getting half a lunch. If the preacher says, go out and share your faith, tell them about Jesus, but they don't give you any practical steps on how to do that. They're not teaching you. They're just preaching to you. Make sure, as you are listening to preachers, I have my favorites. I listen to them on YouTube. Preachers need to be preached to. That you are learning how to practically do the things the Bible talks about. Last month worldwide, it was the holy month of Ramadan, okay? It's the Muslims' holy month. They take 28 days, and they pray extra, and they fast. And inside a prison, it's an absolute nightmare. It's a logistical headache for a guy like me. But I have to facilitate it. I have to make sure that the First Amendment is satisfied, and they can practice the religion however they desire to. So I always take special time to pray for the Muslims, that God would reveal himself to them and they would understand that salvation doesn't come from the Quran, it comes in Christ. Well, one day I was making rounds and a guy comes to the door and he says, Chaplain, I need you to pray for me. And I was like, oh, all right. I look at his tag, he's a Muslim. I'm like, well, I said, I'll pray for you. What do you need? He said, Chaplain, I need peace. So I look inside his window and on his desk is a Quran. I said, well, you're not going to find any peace in that book. I don't care that it calls itself a religion of peace. The angel, Satan masquerades as an angel of light. Doesn't make him any less the devil. Right. Cool. Yeah. So as we're praying, or as I'm talking to him, I said, you're not going to find any peace there, but I can talk to you about the Prince of Peace, the one who has a peace to give to you, and the peace that he gives you isn't like the world gives. There's no takesy-backsies with Jesus' peace. And he goes, yeah. He goes, that sounds good. He goes, I was raised in the church. I go, oh, so you know what I'm talking about. He said, yeah, but I kind of went astray. I said, oh, sure sounds good. I said, can I tell you a story? Yeah, I'll be all right. I said, there was a shepherd had 100 sheep. One of them walked off. That's what sheep do. Sheep have sense enough to wander off, but not sense enough to find their way back. Uh-huh. I said, but the cool thing about that shepherd is he left the 99 of the 100 that he had right where they were, and he went off to find that one.
Yeah.
He goes, Jack, I'm not sheep. Bingo. Right? In the middle of the Muslim holy month of Ramadan, I led one of theirs back to Christ because he recognized he was the lost sheep that had gone astray. There's the distinction in preaching a passage. Now go find that lost sheep. No, no, no. Tell him. Help him see that he's lost. Then tell him about the shepherd who will leave the 99 and come and bring them back. And that's what Paul says I did with you. I didn't shrink from preaching to you anything that was profitable and teaching you, both in public and in private. It means Paul had a public ministry, a bigger ministry, and a private ministry, maybe small group ministry. He had people that he would meet in their home and would go and instruct them. It tells me that there's more than one way to do church, right? There's more than one way to teach and admonish and preach and the Word of God. Big open settings like this one, meeting in homes. I'm part of a small group that's made up of people from four different churches. We don't even worship together, but we come together once every week, every other week, depending on kids' sports schedules, because we know it's important to get together and sharpen one another and draw strength from one another. He says, "What I testified both to Jews and to Greeks." So this is a varied audience. He's not just preaching to the same group of people. There's his people, which are the Greeks, but he's also, or the Jews, but he's also the apostle to the Gentiles. As we live out our life, if we're expecting God to do something in our lives, we can't just say, those people over there, I'm not going there, I don't like them. Like, it's political season. You know, we're about to become more Republican or Democrat than we are Christian. Mm. Right? I don't care what color you are. You got to preach to the other color if they need it. You've got to look at them like Jesus looked at the rich young ruler. He looked at him and loved him and said, "One thing you lack." Right? He looked at him and he loved him. And then he told him the truth. He exposed something about himself. That's Paul. I preach to both Jews and Greeks. And this, it's like my favorite part almost. Second favorite part of this passage. What he preached was repentance towards God and faith in Jesus Christ. If you don't preach both, you haven't given them the full gospel. Because if they're going to turn to Christ, they have to repent, right? But a person can repent. They can say, "I'm really, 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 really sorry," and never turn to Christ, and they haven't been saved. Mm-hmm. You need repentance from your sins, acknowledgement that you were wrong, that you've lived your life according to your own rules, and you've screwed it up, and that God is the only one that can change it. So you place your faith in the one who died to set you free from the sin that you keep committing. This is the heart of Paul's gospel. And it's the same thing that we see in the gospels. John's gospel was a gospel or a baptism. John's baptism was a baptism of repentance, right? But it was Jesus who would come along with the good news. This is the message that Paul preached. This is the message that we have for a world. Everybody wants to go to heaven. I guarantee you. And most people think they're going there. But if they've not acknowledged their sin and repented of it, they can believe in God all day long and still continue in sin. And if you read 1 John, he says, no one who has a habit of sinning has the love of the Father in them. You can't love God and love your sin at the same time. God, if you've been saved and you've backslidden, the Holy Spirit will not let you enjoy your sin. It's not possible to be a spirit-filled believer and still be captivated by the ways of the world. The message he preached was repentance toward God and faith in Jesus Christ. And he is now, "I'm going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit." Some translations say compelled. Bound is another good word that this Greek word means. Literally bound in chains. I'm headed to Jerusalem and I'm being led there by the Holy Spirit. And he goes, only thing I know, that the Spirit keeps telling me every city I go to, you know what? I know what's going to happen. There's going to be imprisonment and afflictions awaiting me. So he knows he's being led by the Spirit to go to these places. And he knows that the Spirit is telling him when you get there, imprisonment and affliction are on it's on the docket. It's going to happen. How many of you would start to question, go, was it really God? Like, imprisonment and affliction doesn't sound like something I'm really into. I would question. Paul sees this prediction of what awaits him, but what he doesn't do is see it as a prohibition. He doesn't let what he knows is happening stop him from going where the Spirit wants him to go. Why? Because he knows he's going to face struggles. He knows it's going to be trial and hardship. And he'll go on, but I don't account my life of any value or precious to myself. Now this, how do you stop a guy like that? What are you going to do to a guy like this that's going to make him peel back and slow down? Nothing. Nothing is going to stop a guy who's believes he's being led by the Spirit, even when the Spirit tells him bad things are going to happen, he's like, sign me up, I want double. Because what's my life? What's my life if all I do are things that are good for me? We're going to go on. He's going to talk about the church that he serves. I pastor at Watsontown Baptist Church. It's not Josh's church. This isn't Ron's church. Ron didn't die for this church. I didn't shed blood for my church. It's Christ's church. We serve him. He's the only one that we do any of this for. And he says, so my life, what do I care? Prison, beatings, I'll deal with it. Because I know that my Christ, my Lord, suffered and was beat in the same way. Peter didn't want to suffer in the same manner because he didn't consider himself worthy to endure the same punishments that Christ endured. Suffering was an expectation for the early church. We insulate ourselves from suffering, we get out of bed the wrong way in the morning and we just start complaining. Paul's like, look, what are you talking about? It's going to happen. Embrace it and love God through it. I don't consider my life or anything. The Holy Spirit's predicting bad things and Paul says, I'm in. It's not a prohibition. That I only may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus. In 2 Timothy 4, the last chapter, the last letter that Paul writes to Timothy, he's writing to Timothy because he's placed him in charge of this church after he left. And in that, he says that I have fought the good fight, I have finished my race, and I have kept the faith. The one thing that Paul says I want to do, that I only may finish the course, finish the race. And at the end of his life, he can look back on it and go, I did it. Right? No regrets. No turning back. He decided to follow Jesus and he set his eyes straight on him. And wherever the Spirit, as if he was bound to him in chains. See, the cool thing about working in the prisons, and I got really good at maneuvering people in chains. And the interesting thing is, when they got shackles on here, handcuffs here, and they're tied to their waist with chains here, they will go wherever you tell them to. And if they don't, you just yank on the chain and make them go where you want them to. And that's Paul with the Holy Spirit. He's bound to him. He's constrained to him. And he won't do anything that isn't Spirit-led. He's even going to have people telling him later on, I believe the Spirit is telling me don't go to Jerusalem. Paul's like, you misheard. No, we know, we don't go to Jerusalem. Bad things wait for you there. Don't go. He goes, no, the Spirit is telling you bad things are going to happen to me in Jerusalem because the Spirit told me bad things are going to happen to me in Jerusalem. But the Spirit is telling me I'm going to Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Even what we would think of as godly counsel. Paul goes, I know where the Spirit has me going. I know what I'm supposed to do. And I know what awaits me when I get there. He had to go. So, he says he has the ministry he has, he received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of God, and behold. So, Paul's kind of laying this all out. Now he starts to make a turn. Now, the reason that he's there becomes so clear. He says, now behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again. He says, I'm leaving. I'm not coming back. Paul's visited Ephesus. This is his third time. It'll be his final time. And in the different times that he left, he would say, Lord willing, I'll come back. Or I'll come back. He's back. But he's not coming back. And this breaks their heart because of everything that they've seen him do, everything that they've learned from him, everything that they've been taught and instructed. And these are the elders in that church. These are the ones that he's leaving it to and entrusting it to. He's passing the torch on to them. He's fed them, and he's taught them how to cook, and now he's telling them to go feed other people. Preaching and teaching. Hey, eat the food. Great, that's preaching. Do that. What do we do when there's no one there to feed us? I'm going to teach you how to cook. And so you know how to do what I did for you when I'm gone. It's the perfect picture of what Jesus left us on the mountain. He went up to heaven. It's the Great Commission. Make disciples. Right? Be people. Here's the thing about making disciples. I heard a preacher one time go, when it comes to making disciples, you need to ask yourself one question. Would the world be better or worse if there were two of you? Right? Because that's a disciple. You teach them the faith that you have. So is what you have worth passing on to the next person? That's a question that will make you sit straight up in your pew. It made me sit up in my recliner when I was watching it on my phone. And it stuck with me. But Paul had preached and taught. He fed them, he taught them how to cook. Now he's telling them, you gotta go back and you gotta feed the people. You've got to do for them what I did for you. They need you. Therefore, because of all of this, I testify you that I am innocent of all of the blood of all. That's a weird thing to say, isn't it? Like, you never read any stories about Paul going after something. Like, Peter, we can see Peter doing this. He's chopping guys' ears off in the garden. Like, Peter would be like, I'm not exactly innocent of all blood. Why would Paul say it? There's a text back in Ezekiel, chapter 33. The Lord speaks to Ezekiel. He says, Son of man, I've made you a watchman for the house of Israel. So hear the word I speak and give them warning from me. When I say to the wicked, O wicked man, you will surely die, and you will not, and you do not speak out to dissuade him from his ways, that wicked man will die for his sins, and I'll hold you accountable, because you didn't tell him. But if you do warn the wicked man to turn from his ways, and he does not do so, he will die for his sin, but you will have saved yourself. Also, I've warned everyone. Everyone that I could possibly tell. Because of that, if they don't turn, that's on them. They're accountable for what they know. They're accountable for what I've taught them. And if they don't turn, that's on them. Right? It's their job. The Holy Spirit works in the hearts, and God gives the faith to turn and repent. And if they have it and they reject it, that's the unforgivable sin. That's the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, because you can't forgive someone something they don't want to be forgiven for. Paul says, because of that, I've warned them, I'm innocent of the blood of all men. Because I didn't shrink from declaring to them the whole counsel of God. I took them through the Old Testament, Genesis to Malachi, if they had that. And then he gets into these marks of ministry. Pay careful attention to yourselves. He's preparing them to do what he did. Every person inside the church, pay careful attention to yourselves. Because your work for God will not exceed your walk with God. If you want to be used mightily with God and you are not, step back. Examine yourself. How's my walk going? I had a seminary professor. He said that as you grow in ministry and as you pastor and as you do different things in ministry, as the tree goes higher, the roots must go deeper. Because if you're growing your tree, your public ministry, your persona, you're writing books and you're getting all these, you have more degrees than Fahrenheit, but your shape is fallow, at some point that tree's going to topple over and you're going to look like a fool. Paul knew this. You've got to examine yourself. You've got to be in your word every day. You've got to be praying every day. What's the most important thing a pastor can do for his congregation, Ron?
Pray for him.
Pray for him. You want to know the work that happens up here starts in our study on our knees. Right? We know where everybody sits, so we can just go down the row and just like pray for them and pray for them and pray for them and pray for Steve and pray for Don. We know you sit in the same spots every Sunday. If you go to this church, how many of you are sitting in the same spot tonight that you sit in church on Sunday? Yeah, see? That's a word of knowledge from the Lord right there. Right? But we have to examine ourselves. If we're going to be used by God, we've got to be walking with him every day. We've got to consistently and constantly choose God over the world, because the world is encroaching on our faith. It wants our time, it wants our talent, and it wants our treasure. The world is pulling everything that we have to give back to God. It wants to pull away from us. The reason I got to this text tonight is because of my personal study. I've been looking at the parable of the four soils. And I've been looking at all of the barriers to advancing the kingdom of God. Satan is one of them. The cares and deceit of wealth is another one. And the second one is a shallow root. You receive the root with joy, but you're never, the word with joy, you're never discipled. And when persecution comes on account of the word, you go, I didn't sign up for this. I'm out. I'm going to roll. The world is, the world, that third soil, the one where the deceitfulness of wealth and riches and the cares of this world, it says that it chokes out the plant so that it can't produce fruit. The world will try to put a chokehold on the word, will try to make it ineffective so that it renders the plant fruitless. We have to examine ourselves. And he says to the flock, examine yourselves into all the flock which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. So the Holy Spirit chooses you to work. He's telling the Holy Spirit chose you to be the overseers of this flock. But if you're a father, you've been chosen to be the overseer of your family. You lead your wife. You pray for and raise up your children in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Right? You train up your children in the way that they would go, so when they're old, they don't depart from it. The Holy Spirit has placed you in that role. But if you feel underqualified, it's okay. You have the Holy Spirit. You have Him in you as an advocate and a counselor. How many of you dads, especially, if your children came to you when they were young and they said, "Dad, I've been listening to what you say. I've been paying attention when you say, clean up your room, put away your Legos and your Barbies." And they say, "Dad, I want to do that, but I don't know how. Will you help me?" How many of you are going to turn them away? No one. No one is going to turn away. So when you go to this word, when you open this book and you go, "Oh boy, I don't know what it says. Dad, I want to make you happy. I want to please you. And I want to do what it says. But I don't know how. Will you help me?" How much more so, the Bible says, will the Heavenly Father give good gifts, right? Give the Holy Spirit to those who seek Him and ask for it. But we let our pride get in the way. I'm a preacher. I've been studying this book for a long time. And I read, there's one passage that, I thought I understood it once. It still baffles me. I know at some point, in the moment that I need it, God will give me the clarity, and that will just, and I'm like, man, how did I not see this when I was 17? But I've been tripping over it for a long time. I keep asking Him to help me, and He will. I know He will, because He's a good Heavenly Father. Anyway, that wasn't part of my notes. He tells them to shepherd the church which God has obtained with His own blood. Right, Ron? It's God's church. It's not our church. We just get to serve and shepherd here. He says, "I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock." This is why I picked this text for revival. That whole thing was my introduction. I'm kidding. But this is why I picked this text. This is my favorite part of this text. He says, "I'm leaving you." They're heartbroken that He's leaving them. And He's telling them, "After I leave, wolves are coming in." Mm-hmm. How does He know? Because it happened to Him in Corinth, and it happened to Him in Galatia, and there's been Jews plotting against Him since He's been here. He's got Demetrius the silversmith that hates Him. He's got a bunch of people who are trying to stop what He's doing. He goes, "They're coming. I can't hide this from you. You've got to know that these folks are coming. You've got to know that when we go out into the world and we do ministry, Satan is right there to counteract everything that we're doing. The very first problem with the soil, when the seed falls on the wayside, it says the birds came down and plucked it up. And Jesus says that means Satan comes into the ears and he plucks the word out of the ears of the hearer before it ever sets down roots. Big faux pas. Satan never misses church. Ever. Mm-hmm. Some Sundays we wake up and we're like, "Nah, I just don't feel like going to church today. Ooh, stubbed my toe. That was my gas pedal foot. I'm just not going to make it." We will look for excuses to not go to church. And if the gospel is preached in the church, Satan has reason number one to be there, because he wants to pluck it out of the ears of the people who hear it. Because if they hear it, it can change their life forever. How do I know? I know a guy. When I heard the gospel, it was given to me, and I was like, "Dude, how did this guy know that's everything that I'm struggling with? Every sin that I have in my life." It was like someone was behind me holding up a cue card. It was amazing. And then he says, "You don't have to carry that shame, that guilt, that bitterness, that lust in your heart. You don't have to carry it all around anymore." He goes, "You're burdened so heavily." Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest." And I was like, "Dang. Come, I want some rest. Pick me. I want the Jesus guy." And I got it. And it changed my life forever. At 17 years old, I was probably 2 or 3 bad decisions from doing prison ministry on the inside. Let that one sink in. Right? I was not pure and clean, or, you know, clean as a pure wind-driven snow. But God saved me from all that. And he says, and Paul doesn't sugarcoat that. He doesn't hide the fact that after I leave, people are going to come in and they're going to try to undo everything I did, which is why you need to be alert, be on your guard. He said, because people from your own flock are going to come in and twist the things that I say.
Yep.
People from your own number are going to try to undo some of the stuff that I did. Why? Maybe to make a name for themselves. Maybe because the things that I said sounded too mean. Maybe because it hurt their feelings, and they're going to try to soften some of the teachings of the Word of God. Any preacher that stands up here and tries to soften the Word of God is not preaching the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
He's tickling ears. And I'll tell you what, those guys can grow a church. Man, can they draw a crowd.
Yes.
When people want to feel affirmed and validated, they will go hear that guy all day long. But Jesus warned about false teachers. Peter warned about false teachers. Jude warned about false teachers. James warned about false teachers. Luke warned about false teachers. The Apostle John warned about false teachers. Every writer in the New Testament warned about false teachers. Listen to what Peter said about it. He said, false teachers indulge the flesh in its corrupt desires, and they despise authority. They are unreasoning animals. They are stains and blemishes. They have eyes full of adultery. Their hearts are trained in greed. They're accursed children. They're springs without water. They are misdriven by a storm for whom black darkness has been reserved. They are slaves of corruption. They are dogs that return to their vomit, and they are pigs wallowing in the mud. That's how he described false teachers. None of that has any positive, redeemable quality to it. None of it. And Paul says, it's coming. You've got to know that if you're working, Satan's working against you.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't want this message going out because it takes people from his kingdom and puts them into God's. Paul would write that he has redeemed us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. There is a battle going on. That's how I got in this text. By studying spiritual warfare and understanding that we don't battle against flesh and blood, but against powers, principalities, and the rulers of this air, in this dark world. And he doesn't hide it. And a preacher, a pastor, will not hide the hard things from you. He will equip you to deal with them. That's our job. Equip the saints to do the works of service. So that when you leave here, you don't just feel good about yourself. You feel strong enough like Paul to like, I'm going, afflictions and imprisonment await me, and I'm happy about it. That's what preachers should be doing. You should leave here built up and encouraged. If you leave here convicted, that is also the Holy Spirit. He's saying straighten up and fly right. You've gotten a little off course. Let's correct. They're coming. They're going to come out of your own number. And they're going to twist things. And they're going to drag you away. And they're going to try to get you to follow them and not Christ. So he goes, just remember, for 3 years, I didn't cease night or day to warn you, every one of you with tears, as part of that internal struggle. He loved so hard. He cared so much that they needed to know. He says, I spent 3 years warning. You're crying because I'm leaving, but I spent 3 years preparing you. He says, I worked for myself. I didn't take anything from anybody that I wasn't needing. As he said these things, he knelt down and he prayed with them. Final words of encouragement, but a final plea to God to help them stay strong in the midst of what they know is coming. He left his son in the faith, Timothy, in charge of the church. 40 years later, John the Apostle writes a letter to this church, and I already alluded to it. He tells them, he praises them for their faith. He praises them for their intolerance of false teaching, their love of sound doctrine. He says, but your hearts have grown cold. You've forsaken your first love. In 40 years, most of the people in that church would have been second generation Christians. They would have received what they have then from their parents. And he says, your love has grown cold. Today, archaeologists will tell you there's the city of Ephesus is an archaeological site. There is no church there. They didn't self-correct. They didn't straighten up and fly right. It was overtaken at one point by the Muslims, and that was nothing there. Kind of a downer way to close out a message. you to the people to your left and to your right, not in here, but out there. God has to be doing a work inside our lives every day so that you can give away what you have. And I guarantee you, as you give yourself up or give yourself out and your faith with it, Christ will backfill whatever it is you give away.
Yes.
He is the well of living waters. It will not, when you drink from it, it will not go dry.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot outgive God.
Amen.
And if you love, He has more love. Right? He gave you life, and life abundantly. When you have something in abundance, the very definition means that you have more than you know what to do with. Right? Last year was a good year for tomatoes. I have an abundance of tomatoes. I didn't know what to do. I don't even like them. I just like to grow them. But God promises to give us more life than we know how to give. More life than we know how to live. And that's why we give it away. And we tell everyone about the goodness of our God. So this revival message, I want it to be one of encouragement. Stay in your word. Bring your Bibles to church. Stay in the word. Stay in prayer. Dedicate. I don't care if it's the first thing you do in the morning. It's helpful. Because the only part of my day that I can control with any reliability is when it starts. If I set my alarm for 5 a.m., I know it's going off at 5 a.m. Beyond that, any number of interruptions can come my way, and I'm playing catch up the rest of the day.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't start first thing in the morning, start when you sit down to, instead of watching the news, drink your coffee and talk to the Lord. But let Him work in your life so He can work through your life. I'm grateful, Ron, that you do these services, because we need to hear messages we might not hear on a Sunday morning.
Mm-hmm.
Not that you and I are doing a bad job. But sometimes we need a shot in the arm. Sometimes we need a little bit of a wake-up call. And we need to be reminded what's at stake. I know every soul that dies apart from Christ goes to hell. I heard a preacher one time say of D.L. Moody. You guys know who D.L. Moody is? A colleague of his spoke of him. He says he's the only one that is qualified to preach on hell. Because when he does so in tears. Because the thought of it breaks his heart. Man, that's the kind of love Paul had for the churches. That's the kind of love your pastor has for you. Can't bear to see it. And that's why sometimes we'll preach the hard things. We'll give you the whole counsel of God. Because we need it. We need every word in this book. We live off of it. Every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Father. Not just the ones we like. Not just the bumper sticker verses that make us feel good. But every word. So, every morning, get into the Word. Read it. And memorize it. Share it. And most of all, live it. Because that's what will revive a church. Living out the Word of God. I'm going to close. We're going to close in an unconventional way, at least for my sermon. I'm going to quote a song. It's lyrics from a DC Talk song. Remember DC Talk from back in the day? Right? He says, the single greatest cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips, then walk out the door and deny them by their lifestyles. That is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. So let's not give them a reason to doubt the hope that we have. But let's be ready to give them a defense for the hope that we have every day that we're out there. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for showing up here today and for giving me the words to speak. God, I want to be like Paul, and I just want to be constrained to you, that even if it's hard or it's difficult, God, I know what lies ahead, but I know that what lies ahead, you're going there with me. In fact, the footsteps of the righteous are ordered of the Lord. You've already gone ahead of me. And even if it's suffering, God, you prepared me for it. So I thank you that even when bad times come, we can rest and hope in you, and our hope is secure. God, I pray for each of the people here who have heard your word, and I pray that you've been working in their hearts, that you've been doing something beyond the sounds vibrating in my vocal cords, God, that you have been stirring hearts and changing hearts and lives, so that we can go out there with a message and with fearless like Paul, that this world needs to hear. Thank you, God, for your goodness and your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Scott, you have a closing song. God, do I introduce that wrong?
Scott sings our final song that he has for us. I'm going to put Josh on the spot. If there's something that struck a chord in your heart this evening, and you would like Josh and myself to pray with you, we're here for you. Don't be afraid.
Absolutely.
You're amongst friends. You're going to spend eternity with them. So if you got something that's laying on your heart, we're here to assist you in whatever way that we can. Through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
So, okay, Scott.
Sometimes we hear a song that we've heard 100,000 times before, and you know the song, and you really don't even listen to the words. Anybody guilty of doing that? It's so familiar that you don't really think about what's being said. This is one of those real familiar songs, real familiar old-time country gospel song, but I really want you to listen to the words, because you're going to find a couple phrases in this song that he just spoke. Just little lines that he hit it, and when he was saying it, I was like, that's in the next song.
Go figure.
So things like that don't happen by accident either. Because, you know, basically when I come to sing, I basically say, Lord, what songs do you want me to sing? And he lays a couple songs on my heart, and that's what I sing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I believe that's the way that he wants me to do that. So, again, a familiar song, but listen really closely to the words. We've all been in this song. Maybe some of you are still in this song. So think about that a little bit.
Sorrow inside. Praise the Lord.
right.
Now go out this week and be a light. Shine that light for Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
How about that? Heard some good preaching, some good singing.
That's right.
Amen.
The word of God was lifted up. Let's pray. Lord, we humbly come before you. We've heard the word that comes from the truth called the Bible. Our hearts, I hope, have been stirred, activated, set on fire to go out and to share the truth and the love of Jesus Christ. As has been proclaimed, you are the answer to all the irks and ills of this world. Lord, you have given us a reason to go out and share because you saved us. We came to you. And Lord, we thank you for your shed blood. We walk each day in your love and in your grace and in your mercy. How can we not share that with someone else? Be with us now as we depart from here. I'm going to ask my brothers, Josh, to come up and myself. If you have an incident or something that's weighing heavy on your heart, we're here for you to share that love of Jesus. In his name I pray, the name above all names, amen, amen. Don't miss tomorrow night. Be the closing program. We have coming, Brother Roy is going to be preaching. And we have the Seth Lloyd coming to do the music ministry. Good night, safe travels, and God bless you.